Let me officially welcome everybody to our second virtual Mackey colloquium. This is going to be really exciting. And we have a couple more of those coming up, not next week. Next week we make a small break, but the week after, on October 23rd, we have Professor Manu Platt from Georgia Tech coming to talk to us about his work in tissue engineering and biomechanics. So this is going to be really exciting. But today, you're here because you want to hear Professor Betar Gallant, and I'm going to hand over to Professor Nick Fang, who is going to introduce her.
All right, thank you very much, Matthias. It's really my great pleasure to introduce the guest speaker of today, our own colleague, Professor Betar Gallant. And some of you may have interacted with her in the course of 2006. And she was recognized of the Distinguished Spiral Award of Teaching in 2019 of that. And others of us had also opportunity to collaborate with her on advanced energy conversion devices and greenhouse gas mitigation technologies at MIT. A few words about Betar's history. Dr. Gallant completed all her 3 degrees at MIT in this department. And she took a short pass at Caltech to finish the postdoc as a Kavli Nanoscience Institute postdoc fellow. And currently she's leading the energy and the gas conversion laboratory. And her research is well recognized with many awards. Here I'm just naming a few. The American Bureau of Shipping and Career Development Chair, the Army Research Office Young Investigator Awards of 2019, and more recently, the Scilog Fellowship in Energy Storage and in Negative Emission Science. Without further ado, let me take the podium to Betar, please.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Matthias. Okay, and thank you to all of you for the opportunity to share my work with you today. My group researches electrochemical materials and reactions with a strong emphasis on developing new types of electrochemical mechanisms and processes. So our work aims to build foundational knowledge that allows us to pursue some challenging frontiers in electrochemistry research and is guiding design of new technologies that address critical needs in the areas of energy and the environment. But before starting, I want to make sure to acknowledge my group members who are conducting this research and working hard every day to make exciting discoveries that will form the basis of what I will share with you today. Okay, so over the coming decades, we are going to be living in a world that is governed increasingly by demands for electrification and decarbonization. So right now, global CO2 emissions are in excess of 35 gigatons per year. And to stay below the threshold for 2 degrees C warming, the IEA and IPCC roadmap tells us that we need to rapidly reduce our emissions by mid-century. So to achieve this, we are going to need immense efforts in the areas of increasing renewables, improving energy efficiency, and switching to low carbon fuels, which includes vehicle electrification. So my research is contributing to these electrification needs by developing high energy storage technologies that we hope can one day do better than today's state-of-the-art lithium-ion batteries, as well as new electrochemical energy concepts that we hope can also one day expand our portfolio of battery chemistries for a future of electric mobility. So on the other hand, we are not going to meet our targets without managing CO2 emissions directly. So in the last part of my talk, I will describe how we are working to address some of the central challenges in CO2 capture, conversion, and storage. And I hope to convince you that there are exciting new opportunities for electrochemistry to play a growing role here. So I'll start today with our work on energy storage. What's shown here is our current benchmark technology, the lithium-ion battery. We have a graphite anode or a negative electrode and a transition metal oxide cathode or positive electrode. So during discharge, electrons flow from externally through a circuit from the anode where they're in a higher energy state to the cathode, while the lithium ions transport through the electrolyte to balance the charge. And the energy density gravimetrically of the cell is given as a product of cell voltage and gravimetric capacity. And so for today's materials, capacities are on the order of several of hundreds of milliamp hours per gram. So this unfortunately collectively brings us short of the DOE targets what's necessary for mass market electric vehicle penetration of 350 watt hours per kilogram. Today we're at about 260 watt hours per kilogram. And there are also significant challenges remaining related to costs, insufficient cycle life, and safety issues that are still being worked on. So one strategy to begin to enable higher energy batteries is to replace the graphite anode with lithium metal. So lithium has a very high theoretical capacity, as you can see here, of 3,860 milliamp hours per gram, and a low potential that's comparable to graphite, which allows us to retain high overall cell voltages. So in fact, the ability to use lithium has been so compelling and so sought after over the years that it is very commonly referred to as the holy grail of battery technology. So the challenge with lithium, of course, there's a big challenge. There's a reason why we don't see it in our cells today. And that challenge originates with the very high reactivity of lithium metal. So lithium is very reducing, and electrons on lithium are in a very high energy state. So lithium tends to react pretty readily with almost anything that's brought into contact with it. And that includes nearly all electrolyte molecules such as organic solvents and salts. So as a result, this leads to formation of what is called a solid electrolyte interphase, or SEI, which is derived from products of this reaction. And the SEI forming reaction proceeds until the SEI is thick enough to become blocking to electrons and to lithium atom migration, which tends to be somewhere in the on the order of tens of nanometers. So fortuitously, the SEI is ionically conductive, so we can transport lithium ions through it. And in fact, it's actually thanks to a similar SEI that forms on graphite that we have lithium ion batteries at all. So graphite's SEI is actually relatively stable, although it does degrade slowly over time, leading to the battery degradation issues that we're all familiar with. So on lithium, however, the anode undergoes a very dramatic volume expansion. It contracts and expands so dramatically during cycling that the fragile SEI is readily degraded. And this creates problems because then it needs to reform. So this leads to continuous electrolyte consumption, low coulombic efficiency, which is defined as the amount of charge that you get out when you charge the lithium anode following a previous plating step. So it's the ratio of charge you get out over what you put down. And there it also underlies significant safety issues. So one of the major frontiers in electrochemistry is learning to design the interfaces that we want. And there's an opportunity here because the SEI is electrolyte derived, so that if we can understand it better, we can think about ways to design the electrolytes and additives we need to improve it. So to dig a little bit deeper into the SEI, here is a proposed model based on experimental data that's been obtained over decades by the battery community. So it conveys our current understanding, although this is only a model and it's still very actively being studied and refined. So typically closest to the lithium interface, you see the most reduced or ionic phases such as lithium fluoride or lithium oxide. Thus, this is typically referred to as the inner or ionic layer of the SEI. And farther away, closer to the electrolyte, you see less reduced phases such as semicarbonates and polyolefins. And the reason that our understanding is quite incomplete is because measuring the SEI is quite non-trivial. So it's extremely thin, it's fragile, and it's very air reactive, all of which pose huge challenges. So in addition, the chemical complexity of the SEI actually makes it very challenging to make connections between the underlying composition and the function and performance of this interface. So to address this, my group has been attempting to simplify this interface so that we can make it more amenable for study. So we've been developing model systems, model interfaces that consist of single components of the SEI, which we then can take and subject to experimental characterization. And in doing so, we're interested in determining things like transport properties, chemical stability, and electrochemical stability. Step by step, we're using these studies to try to paint a holistic and improved understanding of what does a better SEI look like. So it turns out that we think that this is a powerful approach because we can attribute any differences in behavior to the interface that we know is there. And we're already gaining some insights into differences between these components that were previously little understood. So we've focused so far on lithium oxide and lithium fluoride, which will be the basis of my talk today. So to fabricate lithium oxide, we use the simple, relatively simple reaction between lithium metal and oxygen gas. So to create a representative SEI, we need to aim for the following properties. So we want the fabricated interface to be conformal, pinhole free, it needs to have commensurate thickness to an SEI, so less than 100 nanometers, and we need it to be electronically blocking and ionically conductive. So we study the synthesis over a range of conditions, and at temperatures above 175 degrees C, we see evidence that we've achieved this conformal coating because the interface successfully protects lithium against reactivity with air. And SEM images show us from a top-down view that the lithium oxide interfaces are smooth, with the exception of those that are formed above the melting temperature of lithium, which tend to be rougher. And we can also look at a cross-sectional view where we intentionally bend the sample to actually break the very fragile lithium oxide interface and expose the unreacted lithium underneath, as shown here. And that is so that we can estimate the thickness. And you'll see here that typical thicknesses under most conditions are about 20 to 30 nanometers, so in the ballpark that we were aiming for. To create lithium fluoride interfaces, we react lithium with a different gas, nitrogen trifluoride or NF3. So this reaction imparts lithium fluoride only to the interface, and nitrogen leaves as a gas without reacting further with the underlying lithium. So we have confirmed similar outcomes as we did with lithium oxide, namely that under the right conditions, we can generate a conformal coating consisting entirely of lithium fluoride. And it has commensurate thickness, about 50 nanometers in this case. So I've omitted a number of details, but if you're interested in our fabrication, I refer you to our publication, which is listed down below. So once we have these interfaces, the first objective is to measure the transport properties. And we started out looking at lithium oxide, and then I'll comment on the end by comparing it with lithium fluoride. So given the challenges of directly measuring the SEI normally, our understanding of transport in these interfaces is actually based on our understanding of bulk materials typically. And these measurements are typically conducted on pellets and at higher temperatures, and then their conductivities need to be extrapolated down to room temperature to understand how the interfaces may behave in realistic environments. Those measurements have suggested conductivities of about this ionic conductivity of lithium oxide, so about 10 to the minus 12 Siemens per centimeter. It's important to note that there are some limitations here. So these measurements, while a good start, they don't have lithium metal present, so they're not conducted at the chemical potential that an actual interface would experience when present in an SEI. So using our single phase interfaces, we saw an opportunity to measure these properties at the chemical potential of lithium. And our approach is based off of impedance, electrochemical impedance spectroscopy, along with a fitted model of the interface, which you can see here. So the model includes a space charge region between the lithium and the lithium oxide interface in parallel to a typical RC circuit. So we take the measurements in symmetric lithium-lithium cells with the modified interface present on both. And we utilize a carbonate-based electrolyte as shown here. So the typical impedance spectra are shown here, and we fit this first higher frequency semicircle, which we do that because we understand that that corresponds to the ionic inner layer of the SEI based on work by others, so most representative of the lithium oxide interface. So I will come back to you and discuss the second semicircle later on. So we first extract the capacitance, and by accounting for the known area and dielectric constant of the relevant material, the model actually outputs what it thinks the SEI thickness needs to be. And then this is actually very important because we can use this as experimental validation. So we can compare this with thicknesses that are independently measured by both X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy sputtering and also by SEM, and the results agree very well. So this gives us confidence in the physicality of the model. So I won't spend too much time on the remaining details, but we can then extract the ionic conductivity once we know the thickness, and also the diffusivity and the carrier concentration once these parameters are known. Okay, on to some results. So we were successfully able to measure the ionic conductivity, the diffusivity, and the charge carrier concentration. And I want to note that these measurements are, we plot them as a function of the formation temperature. So that's the temperature at which the interfaces were synthesized, but the measurements are conducted at room temperature. So here I'll just focus on a key outcome, which is that we measure the ionic conductivities on the order of 10 to the minus 9 Siemens per centimeter, or about three orders of magnitude higher than the number I gave you previously. That is what we get from measurements of bulk lithium oxide powders. So this is not a very high number where ionic conductors are concerned, but it's actually very consistent with what is measured in a native SEI, both by us and by others in the literature. So our updated values help us explain a discrepancy that has puzzled researchers about why the SEI appears to be more conductive than the bulk properties of the SEI would suggest. And it really ultimately has to do, we believe, with the fact that lithium oxide is in a distinct chemical and electrochemical environment when it's in the interface and in a realistic cell compared to, of course, bulk ex situ measurements. What's also interesting is that compared to the all lithium fluoride interface, as shown here, the ionic conductivity of lithium oxide is actually higher by about three times, whereas the conductivity of lithium fluoride is actually much closer to that of the native SEI. So this suggests that lithium fluoride may be more transport limiting, which is a point to keep in mind for later on in my presentation, where I'll come back and talk more about lithium fluoride. So, excuse me. So overall, we are contributing some first experimental data points on phase specific transport that we hope can be of use and directly inform computationalists in continuing to model the SEI and help us better rationalize how it performs. Okay, we also know that the native SEI will evolve chemically over time, but we actually understand relatively little about these chemical processes. So one would think that lithium fluoride and lithium oxide are very stable. You would think that they're basically like rocks, and once they're in the interface, they basically don't do much. And our work is actually showing that it's not quite so simple. So by making the single component interfaces, we've been able to use them as a platform to study the reactivity of these phases. So here I will focus on our emerging understanding of lithium oxide, although we are conducting parallel studies on lithium fluoride as well. So one interesting finding, as I alluded to earlier, that emerged from our impedance spectra is that once we immerse the lithium oxide in the electrolyte, the spectra that we measure actually depend sensitively on the electrolyte, which is unexpected, right? We impart a very particular interface, and then we measure a resulting interface that is actually very chemistry dependent. Okay, so I mentioned earlier that the first semicircle corresponds to the most ionic phase, which we attribute to lithium oxide. In certain electrolytes, such as this top one here, Dole DME, the lithium oxide remains as lithium oxide. However, in other electrolytes, namely those with carbonate solvent, and particularly when we have lithium PF6 around as the salt, we see the emergence of a second semicircle. So this is attributed to a chemical change at the interface that is clearly electrolyte dependent. We used X-ray absorption spectroscopy to understand more about this transformation. This technique is non-destructive to the interface. So it's a good probe. And what we see is that in the least reactive case, so namely in Dole DME electrolytes, the lithium oxide surface indeed remains largely unchanged. On the other hand, in lithium PF6 carbonate-based electrolytes, we see that the outer layer of the SEI actually converts to become richer in fluorine. So akin to this little cartoon that we've included here. So although we typically think of lithium oxide as being completely stable, lithium fluoride is actually more stable. And so we learned that reactive salts can actually drive these conversions. And this is important because this interface is where lithium ions are exchanged between the electrolyte and the SEI. So we can use this to start to rationalize how different reactivity affects the transport and kinetics of plating behaviors of lithium. This also provides some insights into this much more complicated picture that I showed you previously, because we can start to understand conversion pathways between one phase and another and gain insights into how the SEI may get built up over time. Okay, so far we've been talking about properties measured in the interface prior to active lithium cycling. So we next examined how the interface affects plating and stripping. And here I'll be focusing predominantly on lithium fluoride. Why, you may wonder. So lithium fluoride is a recurring motif that appears in nearly all SEIs due to the field's heavy reliance on fluorinated salts. So researchers have also been recently increasingly interested in fluorine-rich fluorinated electrolytes, which have been shown to enrich the interface in lithium fluoride and correlate with good Coulombic efficiency and cycling outcomes. And some reports have even suggested that a preformed lithium fluoride interface is beneficial. So we wanted to examine this question and try to answer what I've posed here. What, if anything, is so good about lithium fluoride in the SEI? So using our all lithium fluoride interfaces, we conducted plating and stripping measurements in symmetric cells. So here I've shown the first half cycle, where you can see there's typically a higher overpotential in the lithium fluoride coated lithium. And this actually persists across subsequent cycling and makes sense because it indicates to us that lithium is actually successfully transporting through the interface where it's more resistive. So lithium fluoride interfaces, we would expect to be more resistive than a native interface. So this starts to make sense. We can then take apart the cells after just one half cycle and subject them to SEM to understand what's happened morphologically. So for the untreated lithium, we see that the, so this shows one side of the cell and then the other is shown here on the side that was stripped and then the side that was plated. So in untreated lithium without any lithium fluoride present, you see that the electrode that was stripped has patches from where the lithium was removed, indicating that it's removed inhomogeneously. And on the other side, we see that the lithium deposits in a porous morphology, which is actually problematic because everywhere you see surface roughening, it indicates that the SEI has had to reform. Okay, so this is our baseline. And we look at the lithium fluoride coated interfaces, and surprisingly, regardless of how thin we were able to make the interface, we could not find any evidence that the lithium fluoride could successfully fully protect the underlying lithium against roughening during cycling. So in fact, after even only one half cycle, the plated morphology looks far more like the untreated lithium than the modified interface that we originally put down. So we believe that this is due to the high resistivity of the lithium fluoride in these fluoride-enriched interfaces. And this is because when the interface is more resistive, we believe that the interface actually impedes ion transport to such an extent that it tends to select for weak spots or weak points in the interface, which then become subject to highly localized lithium plating and degradation of the interface. So to explore this point further, if the lithium fluoride were truly protective, the cycle life of the electrodes should be independent of electrolyte, allowing lithium to basically move through the interface without the SEI needing to reform. So to examine this, we defined a failure criterion. And this graph here shows typical cycling in symmetric lithium-lithium cells, where after some time, you'll see that the voltage starts to spread out or fan out, which indicates that the electrolyte is being rapidly consumed due to SEI repair and the cell is starting to dry up. So we take the point at which the overpotential doubles compared to its initial 10 cycles or so, and we define this as our failure point. So over here, now we look at the failure criterion as a function of different electrolytes. And you can see that the lithium fluoride interface does not appear to impart any advantage in cycle life in carbonate electrolytes. So we further investigated this point by adding in a bit of a fluorine donating additive to see if that would be enough to kind of repair the interface as it breaks down. And we saw some slight improvements, although cycle life was really ultimately comparable between both cases, both the untreated lithium and the lithium fluoride enriched interface. So finally, when we switched the electrolyte entirely, we see that cycle life increased significantly, but both for the untreated and the lithium fluoride treated interface. So what this tells us is that the electrolyte rather than the lithium fluoride is actually determining the cycle life. And what's happening is conveyed in this schematic here, where any breakage induced in the lithium fluoride leads to electrolyte infiltration, which creates a new solvent-derived component of the interface that we believe is far more significant in determining cycling outcomes than the lithium fluoride. We could verify this further by comparing our artificial lithium fluoride with a lithium fluoride enriched SEI that was formed natively by cycling in a fluorinated electrolyte, 7-molar lithium FSI in FEC. So the SEI that forms in this electrolyte is different from our lithium fluoride enriched one. So you have a thinner, more dense lithium fluoride layer of about 5 nanometers closest to the current collector combined with a more amorphous outer layer. And you can see that when we cycle lithium in these electrolytes, we get very high coulombic efficiencies, about 95%. The issue, however, is when we replace the fluorinated electrolyte with a non-fluorinated electrolyte, the coulombic efficiency rapidly degrades. So this indicates that it's not the interface intrinsically that is underlying the good performance or doing the heavy lifting, but it's really the electrolyte. So we can even restore performance by swapping the fluorinated electrolyte out for back for the non-fluorinated one, and the performance comes back. I think I said that backwards. We swap out the non-fluorinated electrolyte for the fluorinated one, and we can restore the performance. So we do see overall that the thinner lithium fluoride plus the amorphous outer layer does cycle better than the all lithium fluoride interface. So we conclude that this type of morphology in the SEI, so thinner lithium fluoride combined with the more elastomeric amorphous outer layer, is better, but it's still important that the electrolyte is really doing the heavy lifting. So overall, our work helped us understand that the key is really all in the dynamics of the SEI repair process. So the SEI acts like a band-aid in a way, and the band-aid is imperfect and it has to be continuously rebuilt. So certainly some electrolytes do this better than others, but the band-aid is really never perfect. So in regular carbonates, once the lithium fluoride is compromised, we see slow electrolyte repair, and that becomes an issue. In highly fluorinated electrolytes, what we propose to explain our results is that the rapid kinetics of repair is really what leads to the better cycling outcomes. But I want to emphasize that we believe there's nothing particularly special about lithium fluoride as a phase once it's already inside the SEI. It's really the process that gets it there that is important. Okay, we've also been developing techniques to learn more about the chemical dynamics occurring in a native SEI. So we know that the electrolyte plays a big role in whether the lithium cycles stably over time or whether it deteriorates, but the question is why? So since the SEI is very challenging, if not impossible, to directly monitor during cycling with our available techniques, we've developed an approach based on operando gas analysis that allows us to obtain important clues as to what we think is happening dynamically at the interface during cycling. So most SEI forming reactions will release gas signatures. And as you can see here, we can actually trigger these reactions electrochemically during a plating step, for example, and then quantify which gases are evolved as a function of electrolyte. So here I will focus first on processes in EC-DMC electrolyte with lithium PF6 salt, and then I'll come back to remark on the pink data points in FEC at the end. So above I've shown the most common SEI forming pathways described in literature and their associated gases along with solid products that are formed in each pathway. So using our operando gas chromatography, we discovered that gases are actually evolved in particular ratios, which allows us to, in a way, solve for the branching ratios of these different pathways. So for example, if you look down here, for an EC-DMC, we see that the ratio of carbon monoxide to methane is around 2. And so that corresponds very well, actually uniquely, to pathway 2 shown up here. So once we account for that pathway, we can go through the same thought process with other gas ratios, and we can quantitatively determine how much each pathway contributes to the overall SEI repair reaction. So here I've just shown the example for EC-DMC electrolyte. So I want to note that although we monitor the gases, each pathway has an associated and distinct solid phase product, such as a semicarbonate shown here or an alkoxide. And so we learned that by in addition to changing the current density, we see some shifts in the reaction pathway that I won't get into here. We also learned that by changing the salt, we can also shift this branching ratio. So for example, using lithium perchlorate salt instead of lithium PF6 shifts towards favoring pathway 3, which favors alkoxides over semicarbonates in the SEI. So coming back to FEC, what is known, we know that this is a fairly good SEI forming additive and solvent. And so here we can see that although with FEC, we do evolve fewer gases overall because it's a more efficient interphase former, the gases that we do form are different proportionally compared to EC, ECD, MC. So in particular, we form predominantly CO and CO2. And there's also significantly more CO than methane, which actually points towards an even more selective pathway, pathway 3, shown up here. So this again points towards an SEI that is richer in alkoxides and poor in semicarbonates. And this really becomes powerful when we put it all back together because we can come back and start to explain the cycling behaviors. So we proposed a descriptor based on the extent of CO2 or CO release from the interface. So we called it decarbonylation or decarboxylation. And it really reflects the tendency of the interface, we believe, to promote formation of alkoxides at the expense of semicarbonates. And we find that the Coulombic efficiency over the first cycles, at least, correlates well with this descriptor. Now, certainly, correlation is not causation. And so we need to continue studying the interfacial chemistry to obtain direct evidence of what we believe are the predominant solid phases that are present there. But as I mentioned, this is very hard to do right now. So in the meantime, our approach is allowing us to circumvent some of these challenges and make progress in gaining some new insights about the chemical dynamics at the interface. So putting our collective insights together, we're developing a picture of what we think could lead to a better SEI. What we've learned so far is that it's important to have fast reactions that form thin ionic phases at the interface. And we think lithium oxide may be just as good, if not preferable to lithium fluoride. We've also learned that the ionic phases alone cannot impart a stable interphase. And so forming a good outer layer is really key. And we think there are more opportunities for intervention and improvement here. So these insights are so far highly consistent with known electrolyte additives that work quite well in improving lithium cycling. And what we're doing now is we're trying to use this knowledge to guide exploration of new classes of additives that we think will combine the right motifs or the right components to hopefully lead to generations of improved electrolytes and additives to get us to where we need to be up to 99.9 or even 0.99 Coulombic efficiency to for lithium to make it in electric vehicles. Okay, so I'm gonna shift gears a bit. So far I've been discussing one strategy to increase energy density of batteries by enabling the lithium anode. And if we're able to use lithium, that's great, but then we're going to very quickly become limited by the performance of the cathode. So today's intercalation-based materials rely on transition metal redox. Transition metals are heavy and they can store only 1 to 2 electron per transition metal. So we have capacities in the range of, let's say, 120 to 180 milliamp hours per gram. So another strategy to significantly increase energy density of batteries is to really reconceive the types of reactions that we use at the cathode. So there's been significant interest in replacing intercalation or lithium storage based reactions with conversion reactions that involve a phase change. So for example, reacting a gas such as oxygen to a solid such as lithium peroxide during discharge, which is a system that I actually worked on during my PhD. So there have been many types of such conversion cathodes proposed, and you'll notice over here that what is attractive about them is they tend to have very high theoretical capacities up to or exceeding 1000 milliamp hours per gram, although they tend to have slightly lower voltages compared to lithium ion. So many of these batteries, including lithium oxygen, have been proposed as rechargeable batteries, although they face continue to face significant hurdles in making them truly reversible over the cycles we need. So my group has been looking to expand the map of available chemistries from where we sort of started up to this exciting space here, where you see there's a, we can potentially combine high theoretical capacity and high voltage to design in a space of unprecedented high energy density. So in particular, we have been working on designing fluorinated reactants as opposed to oxide conversion reactions. And in order to do that, we've had to kind of go out on a limb a bit and do some exploratory research to understand what types of electrochemical mechanisms are possible with fluorinated reactants. Fortunately, it has given us a lot to work with, and so I will summarize what we've learned to give you a taste of why there's a lot of potential here. Okay, why did I become interested in these fluorinated systems? So I became fascinated with the question of how very high energy is stored in reactant molecules and how to tap into this electrochemistry. So I'm going to try to, electrochemically rather. I'm going to try to go through this fairly quickly so I can get to everything I wanted to today, but I was inspired by a thermochemical reaction that is between molten lithium and sulfur hexafluoride gas, which was actually used decades ago to design stored chemical energy propulsion systems for torpedoes. And so thinking about this thermochemical system, we wondered whether we could build an electrochemical analog where we now have a lithium metal anode. And you can think about SF6 as an oxidant, right? The oxidant that reacts with the lithium fuel. And the question was, could we make this into a room temperature battery to try to harness this large theoretical energy that's stored in this reaction? So this is the theoretical reaction shown here. In summary, you react sulfur hexafluoride with lithium and you form stoichiometric equivalents of lithium fluoride and lithium sulfide. And the attractiveness is really in these metrics here where you have very attractive energy density approaching 4,000 watt hours per kilogram. Okay, so we then looked into whether we could actually realize this battery. Up to now, it was just an idea. And long story short, it works. So this shows a discharge curve under constant current conditions where you'll notice right away that the voltage that we obtain is actually lower than the theoretical value of 3.67 volts. We can now reach higher than this, which I'll show you in the coming slides, but there is a penalty that you pay to activate this molecule at room temperature. We could confirm that you indeed do consume 8 electrons per gas molecule reacted by doing these measurements coupled to a pressure transducer. And we know by SEM imaging and separate analysis that you form lithium fluoride, which coats the carbon substrate that's used to conduct the cathode reaction during discharge. So the accumulation of lithium fluoride is what eventually leads the cell to passivate and determines the attainable capacity. We also have looked into the fate of the sulfur. It's a little bit more complicated, but suffice it to say, we have evidence that you form lithium sulfide, and then there's some complex electrochemistry that happens after that, which you're welcome to read more about in our publication. So we've continued studying this system and trying to improve it, and we've learned that the choice of the electrolyte plays a really big role. So if we utilize solvents such as DMSO or DMA, we can see increases in both the capacity and also the discharge voltage. Okay, so I'm starting to get higher over here. We understand now why this is the case. So we understand that when we utilize these particular solvents, they're very good at solvating the fluoride ions that are expelled from the SF6 molecule during discharge. And so what this allows is a more gentler precipitation process of lithium fluoride onto existing lithium fluoride nuclei. And this keeps the cathode surface clear for sustained discharge, so you can get to much better performance metrics. So we're learning how to engineer the electrolytes to significantly improve the attainable energy we can get from these systems. We have pushed this to an extreme, so we can actually now design electrolytes that aggressively engineer fluoride solubility into the cell. I think for the interest of time, I won't spend too much time on this, but I want to highlight that by getting the chemistry just right, we can include molecules that actually specifically bind fluoride ions. And they allow us to get to significantly higher capacities by essentially three-dimensionalizing the lithium fluoride that grows in the cathode. So we were able to increase from our first benchmark system the capacity about 25 times by getting the electrolyte chemistry right. We've also worked on other fluorinated reactants. So I just want to highlight this very quickly. We studied the reaction between lithium and nitrogen trifluoride gas, which discharges by forming three equivalents of lithium fluoride, and nitrogen is released unreacted at the cathode. So I want to just include this to make the point that this particular reaction is not, the sulfur hexafluoride reaction is not unique, but it's part of a family of reactants that we are continuing to develop. The NF3 system also faced issues with lower than theoretical voltage. We've learned that this can be increased somewhat by operating at slightly elevated temperature, but on the whole, this still remains a challenge for this class of reactants. Where this is going is we've already started to significantly expand the family of metal gas batteries that are available to us. And the challenge is, there are actually a couple of challenges. The first challenge, as I mentioned, is we're not there yet, so we need to continue working to increase attainable discharge voltages so we can get closer to the theoretical values. So that's almost entirely the reason why We're really falling short of the theoretical value so far, but we have some ideas about how to develop catalysts and or change the reactant structures in order to get to those higher numbers. So we've increasingly been looking at moving away from gas-based reactants to liquid fluorinated reactants. There's a lot of exciting doors that have been opened here with new chemistries that we are discovering and testing very recently, but I'll just give you the takeaway that we are already seeing significant improvements by moving to these liquid-based reactants where we can get the voltage up, starting to approach up to 3 volts, and very high intrinsic capacities where we can react up to 10 or more electrons per molecule. So I'm going to go through this, and I want to spend the last handful of minutes describing our efforts in the area of CO2 capture and conversion. So this is, of course, a really critical area. And as I mentioned, we're not going to meet our targets without doing something directly about managing CO2 emissions. So typically, when we think about CO2-based technologies, there's, of course, many, many technologies people have been working on. But we have capture upstream, which is what do you sort of do with the emissions that are emitted from a point source? And then there's what do you do downstream once you have captured and separated those emissions? And there's challenges with really both of those questions. So CO2 capture is shown here. So typically you are capturing the flue gases from, let's say, a power plant, and you absorb the CO2 by reacting it with a liquid amine. Typically this is an aqueous solution and you form something like a carbamic acid or a carbamate. And then once the solution is saturated, you need to thermally regenerate this by running it through a stripping unit, and you go back in the other direction. The challenge is that this regeneration step really requires a significant amount of energy, up to 30% of the power plant needed to drive this process. Downstream, electrochemistry has a role to play, and researchers have been looking very seriously at trying to, what do we do with CO2? So I would say most efforts have looked at trying to convert CO2 to some kind of a value-added product, like a fuel or a chemical, as shown here. Because that can help to economically incentivize the capture and mitigation efforts that we want to do. The challenge is that this reaction here, electrochemically converting CO2 to a fuel or a chemical, requires very high energy inputs as well. So the theoretical potential for these reactions is all the way over here at about 0 volts. So in order to get selectivity towards the chemicals or the products rather that we want, you can see we have to put in a lot of excess voltage in order to gain selectivity. And this has to be coupled with a sluggish water oxidation reaction on the other side of the cell. So overall, we again have high energy inputs required and we're still dealing with a selectivity challenge. There's another issue, which is that these two technologies are typically pursued in sort of in a decoupled fashion. So it's not clear if you can do CO2 conversion where the CO2 comes from, but it's likely that that's post-separation. And so you have to conflate or basically multiply these two energy penalties. So what we've been trying to do is to address the issue of storage really doesn't have a solution for what it does with the CO2. And then there are really big energy penalties associated with the overall process. So we've been trying to propose a solution that can start to address both of those challenges. So the question is always, what do you do with CO2? And by many arguments, one of the better things we could do is store it permanently in a phase where it won't get re-emitted back to the environment, which is not the case for making fuels and chemicals. So there's many challenges with geologic storage, one of which is that it's very slow and it's very site specific, and there are a lot of logistics that we need to sort out in order to connect CO2 emitters with storage sites. So here's where electrochemistry has a great opportunity, because we can design technologies that can integrate with point source emitters. And ideally what we want is something that can actually accelerate storage, mineralization, or permanent fixation into a safe, stable, permanent storage phase. And if we can achieve this, we can propose a solution that's distributed, not site specific. So I don't want to lose too much time, but I'll give you a taste of why this is actually very challenging to do, and then I'll show you what we've managed to come up with so far. So CO2 is very inert, which is sort of the crux of the issue. And in order to get it to react electrochemically, typically one has to take it through a kind of activated anionic state, and this requires a large energy penalty. And so what the catalysis community has been figuring out how to do is to lower this energy barrier by stabilizing this kind of high energy intermediate, but we still have the challenges that I outlined to you a couple slides ago. So what we proposed is a different approach. So this is a kind of new reaction pathway for CO2, where we thought, wouldn't it be great if you could take CO2 in the captured state, and instead of having to regenerate it back to a gas, you could actually do electrochemistry directly on this solution and use electrons to basically undo the CO2 binding event rather than having to do a thermal regeneration process. So energetically, this means you would rely on the exothermic nature of the CO2 absorption event. So you go down a little bit in free energy. But then from this state, we are proposing that kinetically, you may gain, things may become kinetically more facile, potentially, allowing you to then direct the captured CO2 to some kind of product that one would want. And so far, we've been looking mainly at forming carbonates. So the red circle here that we use to do all of the effort here is actually translated directly from capture chemistry. So we rely on amines that are also used in CO2 capture, and we've been working on translating them into non-aqueous electrolytes. The reason that we use non-aqueous electrolytes to start with rather than water is it simplifies the reactions quite significantly. These are very complicated reactions, and so figuring out that we were doing the electrochemistry that we wanted and doing a scientific proof of concept was a lot easier to start with a non-aqueous system. And we were looking for evidence basically that we could use electrons to break this bond. This is, would be a nitrogen-carbon bond. And what we want is to cycle the CO2 to a product that only contains CO2 and doesn't contain the amine, because we want the amine to be available to continue to reuptake CO2. Okay, so we did a lot of work to develop the electrolytes. Suffice it to say that not everything worked right out of the gate. So we had to design the electrolyte to incorporate both an electrolyte salt and an amine. And finally, we sort of figured out a viable combination, and we were able to absorb significant amounts of CO2. And typically when CO2 is bound, it looks like this. And we've learned that the active state is actually associated with one of the salt cations, so typically an alkali cation. And that's actually critical for the subsequent transformations that we want to achieve. So we assemble these in cells with lithium anodes. We use a carbon cathode and we bubble CO2 in. It's absorbed into the electrolyte. And we can see that when we've got the amine present, we can basically unlock significant activity in this conversion process. So without the amine, we see very little activity. And with the amine, suddenly we've tapped into a new reaction pathway. We've characterized this extensively. So you form lithium carbonate as the cathode product, and really that's the predominant product. So we don't find any evidence of the amine participating in the or forming the cathode product. In other words, it's not being degraded, which is a good thing. And we grow lithium carbonate in this particular cell configuration in the cathode during discharge. And again, there's no evidence that the amine winds up in the cathode. And in fact, we have confirmed that the amine is free to continue to bind with CO2. So you can turn it over and continue this reaction. We've done isotopic labeling, which I'll go through very quickly, just to say that we are certain that the carbonate that winds up in the cathode is coming from the CO2 that we put in. And here is a summary of a lot of effort that has been swept under the rug today, but I think you can appreciate that this is not a simple reaction, but it boils down to something that is actually, I think, quite elegant, where although we use the amines to uptake the CO2 and they facilitate the conversion to a form of a carbonate, in the end, they don't participate, and you can simplify this reaction as shown here. We take CO2, the alkali metal, and we form a carbonate, and carbon forms as a byproduct. I'm going to skip through this, but we've been continuing now to look at how versatile these reactions can be made. And we are learning that they work with different cations, so different alkali metals, which is a good thing because lithium is problematic, of course, as a consumable. It's really a non-starter. So we need to think about more earth-abundant materials that can be paired with this type of a reaction. And we are collaborating with Elsa Olivetti and Olivia Pfeiffer and GMSE at MIT, and we are looking very carefully at what types of co-reactants are really ideal to be paired with our amine-facilitated cathode process. So as I mentioned, lithium has many embedded CO2 emissions associated with its production, as does calcium and magnesium, but it turns out sodium is an interesting direction to go because of the way that it's produced. So you can actually propose a cradle-to-gate process where you can manage about 60 to 75% of the plant's CO2 emissions. So that's accounting for all of the emissions associated with producing the upstream materials. And I will just zip right through this, but we continue to look at not only non-aqueous reactions, but we're increasingly interested in seeing if this technology can be translated to an aqueous realm where we might be able to look at making protonated products. Okay, so that brings me to the end. So in summary, we've been working to expand the design space in electrochemistry to address ever-growing energy storage and environmental needs. So by proposing, studying, and mastering complex reactions, we're gaining new insights into how to control elusive processes at the interface, how to design new electrochemical reactions, and expand our toolbox of electrochemistry to try to address new challenges where electrochemistry has previously not played a major role. So I want to thank my group members very much for their incredible contributions and exceedingly hard work. Here are some research highlights over the last couple of years. And I also want to thank my funding sources and finally all of you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Really appreciate Betar for your great talk. So we have time for maybe several questions. I see one question from the Q&A channel. This is from Suraj. Suraj, are you still here?
Yeah, he is. I just unmuted him, so he should be able to talk.
Okay, excellent.
All right, Suraj, do you want to go ahead and ask a question?
Sure. So yeah, so great talk. So I was wondering if, because the electron, the ionic conductivity of the SEI that you mentioned, even from your studies, it was about 10 to the minus 9 Siemens per centimeter. So how does it compare to the electron conductivity? And if it's comparable, could there be lithium deposition happening over the solid electrolyte interface layer?
Yeah, the electronic, I assume you mean the electronic conductivity in the oxide or fluoride interfaces. So that's very hard to measure directly. There are estimates from modeling and literature that places it at several orders of magnitude lower than that. But that is something that is actually hard to treat with our model. So we don't directly know. What we do understand is that if there were significant electronic conductivity, we would expect that you would continue to evolve the SEIs as you place them in the electrolyte, because there would be electrons available to react with the organic electrolyte. And in fact, we do see some evidence, as I showed earlier in my talk. So that is something to think about, is electron leakage and whether that's possible through these phases. So unfortunately, I don't, it's very hard to say more, but we are very much thinking about it because that is a relevant phenomenon in SEI evolution.
Okay. I think just as a follow-up on slide 12, I think you had pictures of the plated lithium. Mm-hmm. You had the stripped and the plated lithium. So I was wondering if that was, you had the, you etched out the SEI layer to get that picture, or was the deposition over the SEI layer?
Can you repeat the very end of your question?
So those pictures on slide 12, I think you had about the plated lithium. Mm-hmm. So were those, was the plating, did you get rid of the SEI layer, etch it out to actually get those images, or was
No. We don't do any etching here. This, we just open the cell, and this is, direct imaging.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Suraj.
All right. Thank you, Suraj. We have another question from Ian Hunter. Ian, are you still in the audience?
Yes.
Okay, excellent.
Yes, so Betar, just simply a fantastic presentation.
Thank you.
Really, really awesome. Can you make a few comments about the challenge of creating both high energy density batteries that at the same time have high power densities?
Yeah, so we're thinking a lot about this. So the you need to make something, so for high power, I don't know that there's an innate limitation that says that, you know, all reactants that are high energy cannot be high power, but for the fluorinated reactants, which we're studying very intensively, they need some activation over potential in order to get the reactions to go. So we tend to see, if it's a gas, the gases are quite symmetric. And so structurally, you need to find a way to put electron density onto something that is quite symmetric. And so we think that that's related to why the kinetics tend to be sluggish for things like SF6 and potentially for NF3. We have increasingly been looking at breaking the symmetry of the molecules. So some of the reactants that kind of flew by that are in the liquid phase, we think that we are more successful in getting higher power out of them because there's basically a site that is not just symmetric on the molecule, but where we can actually dump the electrons first. So the asymmetry really helps. So you need something that can kind of unlock the molecular pathway. And we're learning how to design that. So that has been one way to try to combine high energy and high power. But then you also are forming, at least in our reactants, electronically insulating phases, which is a problem. So if you're forming lithium fluoride or something of that nature, that tends to be very challenging for high power. So you can get around it by, liquid reactants are better than gas reactants, but eventually you need to also look at potentially, ideally, if you can make a liquid product, I think that's even better.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Ian. We also have a question from Yang Yu. Yang, are you still at the audience?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Please, go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Professor Gallant. Thanks so much for the nice presentation. And I was just wondering about when you compare different electrolyte, when you do the asymmetric cell cycling and 7-molar LiFSI and FEC electrolyte compared with 1-molar LiPF6 in ECDEC. And you see that after you switch to the 1-molar one, you sort of didn't have that much Coulombic efficiency, and when you switch back to the 7-molar one, and you regain that Coulombic efficiency. So I forgot what rationale you provided, because there are a lot of different stuff that have been changed in this two different electrolyte, right? So one is the volt has been changed, another is the concentration.
Yes.
So what would you think is the major cause for this PF6 electrolyte doesn't have so much Coulombic efficiency as we do this?
Well, we've lost both the FEC and also the high concentration of the FSI. And so we know that the FSI contributes to lithium fluoride formation, and FEC also contributes to fluoride formation and also part of the elastomeric outer component of the SEI. So indeed, we've removed both of them. The point was really to actually, since they're both beneficial, we wanted to see whether their presence is really necessary, right? So in other words, if you form this SEI, if it's really very protective, right, then in principle, if you replace the electrolyte, you can continue to cycle the SEI. And in fact, this SEI, even though it does give us, when the electrolyte is present, it does give us better performance. Actually, sorry, this is a different data set. This is when just in ECDEC, but it does give us better performance, but it needs to be actively regenerated again and again and again. And so we wanted to be clear that the fluorinated electrolytes do get us closer to where we want to be, but they are continuously consumed. And this is important to understand because that needs to be reckoned with when we think about scaling down to small electrolyte volumes and working with lithium if we're talking about using them in practical batteries.
Yeah, so another follow-up question on that. So what if you use just less concentrated LiFSI and FEC electrolyte and cycle it?
That's a great question. Yeah, we did not try that. I would imagine, I don't want to speculate, but that's a very interesting experiment, and potentially maybe it could last longer, right? But I do believe that eventually you're just shifting one consumption of a highly fluorinated electrolyte maybe to a less fluorinated electrolyte, and so it might actually just degrade faster, right?
Okay, yeah, thank you.
We would need to see.
Yeah, thanks.
All right, thank you, Yang. We have two questions still pending on the channel. Let me go to Lalit first, since another one from Saeed do not have access to microphone, so maybe I'll leave that question to Beta when you have time to type. So Lalit, are you still in the audience?
Yes, I am.
Please.
Beta, thank you so much. Wonderful talk. So my question, Betar, can you comment about solid state electrolytes and what is the status and in your view and whether there's any hope for them in the future?
Yeah, seems like there's hope. We've seen some news announcements recently that indicate people seem to be making good progress with them. But I know this is not really what my work has focused on, but I do know that there are a lot of interesting challenges actually, kind of like we see here, that everything really arises from the interface. So the interfaces of solid electrolytes are quite reactive and they need to be stabilized. So just as lithium reacts with liquid electrolytes, the reactivity with the solid electrolytes leads to phase evolution and resistance increases over cycling. There's also issues of, so lithium can actually penetrate or plate through and crack solid, depending on the chemistry, but certain solid electrolytes. And so this is a challenge many people are looking at trying to fix. And they also have some power limitations. So I think that has not kept people from being, from very aggressively pursuing this technology, because if you can use a physically blocking but ionically conductive electrolyte, you can really start to enable use of lithium, which would be great. And the safety gain would be really tremendous, right? The safety gain would be tremendous if we could get it to work. But as far as I know, there's still a lot of challenges.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Lalit. I see that we are already 5 minutes past the clock. So may I suggest that we finish the session, and if you have further questions and comments to Betar, we can keep the podium open for offline discussion. All right. With that, let's thank Betar again for the wonderful seminar.